Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents I Escaped from Auschwitz, the shocking true story of the World War II hero who escaped the Nazis and helped save over 200,000 Jews, by Rudolf Vrba and Alan Bestic. Edited by Robin Vrba and Nicola Zimmering, with a foreword by Sir Martin Gilbert. Narrated by Stephen J. Cohen. Foreword. It is an honor to be asked to write a few words about Rudolf Vrba's book. Like many people of my generation who began reading about the Holocaust in the 1960s, I feel it was a book that made an enormous impact. Vrba was a prisoner in Auschwitz for 21 months and 7 days. He then escaped with his fellow Slovak, Alfred Wetzler. As they made their way south into Slovakia, they carried with them, seared in their immediate memory, as a matter of personal knowledge, the true story of Auschwitz, the hitherto unknown destination of Jewish deportees from all over Europe. The way in which the information brought by the escapees was handled, and mishandled, provides this book and 20th century history with a terrible cry of pain. Alas, we cannot revisit or refashion the past, but through these pages we can learn a great deal about it, and perhaps if we have the courage of a man like Rudolf Vrba, we can do something to prevent the continual workings and spreading of evil. There is much that Rudolf Vrba cannot forgive. In reading this book, one comes face to face with a reality that cannot be expunged, and with a man who deserves the thanks of his people today, as much as he needed their attention and response half a century ago. Sir Martin Gilbert, Merton College, Oxford. Preface. This book consists of a handful of my memories of events that took place more than 50 years ago. It is an attempt to describe A, how the German Reich managed to get me from my native Czechoslovakia into the death camps of Majdanek and Auschwitz against my will. B, some of my experiences as a prisoner in these death camps from June 1942 until April 1944. C. My escape from Auschwitz on April 7, 1944, with a fellow prisoner, Alfred Wetzler, and D. Some relevant events following our escape. I think I should say something about how and why this book was written. Its writing took place in a very different environment while I was on my regular summer holidays in August 1963 in London, England. After the war ended in 1945, I lived in Prague. The city became my real home until 1958, when I left the country. In Prague, I studied chemistry and biochemistry and began my scientific career. To this day, my livelihood is connected with the roots I established there. I cannot recall, during all the time I lived in Prague, if anyone ever asked me what actually happened in Auschwitz. I do not know whether this was caused by a lack of interest or because the subject was taboo. Many events relevant to the real history of the Czech and Slovak lands are connected with Auschwitz. For example, the largest single execution of Czech citizens in the whole history of the people living in Czech lands took place there. This event, which is a part of my personal life, was, perhaps, for the first time, described in my book, written in London. True enough, already in the 50s, the Union of Anti-Fascist Fighters in Prague had arranged an annual Auschwitz commemorative evening, and on one occasion, I even went there. I heard a lot about the heroic Czech communists there. There were dozens of them, as well as hundreds of other Czech citizens, may their memory be honored, who died in Auschwitz for their resistance to the Nazis. During this commemorative occasion, nobody mentioned the murder of the many thousands of Czech-speaking Jewish children who were murdered in cold blood at Auschwitz and became national martyrs, whether they wanted it or not. Nobody mentioned the fate of the Jews either. I recognize some former Jewish prisoners from Auschwitz on the podium. After the meeting, a suspiciously well-dressed gentleman approached me and asked whether I took notice that the podium was full of Jews. I did not answer. It was sometime around the anti-Semitic Slansky trials of 1952, and I did not want to provoke my fate. Later, I worked in Israel, 1958 through 1960, where I spent many hours in the library of the famous Weizmann Research Institute, named after Chaim Weizmann. For decades before and during the Second World War, he had been a leading Zionist. It could be, and indeed it was sometimes claimed, that he was a leader of all Jews. Perhaps that was the reason he became the first president of Israel when the Jewish state was established in 1948. Therefore, I read with interest his account of his leadership and of his life, as he described it in his modestly entitled Trial and Error. In the biography's index, Rehovot is mentioned more than a dozen times. I wondered how many times Auschwitz would be mentioned, considering 100 times more Jews died there than ever lived in Rehovot. To my surprise, I found that the word Auschwitz did not even rate a mention in the lifetime memories of the Jewish leader. I do not know whether this reflects a lack of interest by Weizmann and his circle, or whether the word Auschwitz was perhaps a taboo also in Israel at that time, albeit for some other hidden reasons. In 1960, I was invited to come to England to take up a position on the research staff of the British Medical Research Council. This was a sort of mecca for scientists, and therefore, I was delighted to move to England. I soon acquired many English habits and became an avid drinker of tea and reader of British newspapers, favorite occupations of the English, particularly on Sundays. In 1960, Adolf Eichmann was arrested. Suddenly, in almost all the Sunday papers, the Holocaust was discussed, and the word Auschwitz was frequently mentioned. It had almost become a household word. One of my new friends, Alan Perry, a journalist at BBC, liked to discuss this subject with me, particularly when he noticed I knew more about the subject than he had ever read in the newspapers. He told me that one of the important British newspapers of that time, the trade union's paper, the Daily Herald, had not yet carried a major report on the subject of Eichmann's activities. Alan Perry suggested that the Daily Herald might be interested in publishing an article by me, in light of my intimate knowledge of the subject. "Go and talk to them," he said. I listened to his advice, and soon afterward, one late morning, I visited the headquarters of the Daily Herald. I found out it is not so easy to talk to an editor. Fleet Street, then the center of British journalism, had its own rules. Due to some wrong directions, I had to mill around in a room full of journalists who were having their tea around an enormous oak table, loaded with papers, teacups, ashtrays, and milk bottles. Telephones rang incessantly. The room was filled with a thick cloud of cigarette smoke. One of the journalists approached me, a man of about 40, with his teacup in one hand and a cigarette in the other. He looked at me, an intruder, with great interest. He studied my rimless Trotsky-style glasses. I had them made years before during a lecture tour in Moscow. He noticed my Italian raincoat I'd bought on my way from Israel. He glanced at my good old Prague shoes with their 2-inch-high soles, which had been fashioned in the 50s in Prague, but certainly not in London. He asked me where I was from. When I told him Czechoslovakia, he was amazed. There were not too many people from Czechoslovakia milling around editorial offices on Fleet Street at the height of the Cold War. He glanced once more at my outfit. He then asked me straightforwardly whether I was a spy. I said yes. But I asked him not to spread it around. It was confidential, I insisted. He assured me of his discretion and introduced himself as Alan Bestic, a freelance Irish journalist who had lived in London since the age of 3. I told him about the purpose of my visit to the offices of the Daily Herald and about the topic on which I hoped to write. He considered it hopeless to try to buttonhole the editor in this unconventional way. He suggested we write the article in a standard form and only thereafter offer it to the editor. We then went for a drink at the nearest pub. There were a lot of them on Fleet Street. I was invited to the Bestics for the weekend in his home in Surrey to compose the article with my new friend. That weekend, we spent much time over many cups of tea discussing how I had spent my time during my 21 months and 7 days as a prisoner in Auschwitz. We discussed my escape with my friend, Alfred Wetzler, from Auschwitz, how we wrote the report on Auschwitz after our escape, and what happened immediately thereafter. I was pleased to see that Bestic wrote shorthand faster than I spoke. He transcribed it on his old rickety typewriter. It sounded like machine gun fire and came out rapidly, usually without typing errors. Bestic thought we would need more than one installment to keep the narrative alive and comprehensible. He also added with a frown that it was unusual for the Daily Herald to publish more than 2 installments on the same subject. However, he wrote 3 installments of 1,000 words each and hoped he would be able to negotiate with the editor to settle for 2 installments. A week later, he phoned to tell me I should come to stay at his house for another weekend. He said the editor had read the proposed article. To Bestic's surprise, he wanted 5 installments from me to be printed over an entire week, Monday to Friday. So we wrote a narrative in 5 installments, each about 1,000 words long. A week later, Bestic invited me to his house to celebrate the acceptance by his editor of our 5-installment article of 5,000 words. On that occasion, he asked me to sign a contract, giving the Daily Herald the rights to publish the article. He also handed me a check to compensate me for my time sacrificed on behalf of the Daily Herald. I glanced at the check. It was exactly equal 1 year of my or anybody else's regular salary as an independent research worker at the Medical Research Council. Later, I heard rumor that at a party of his peers, the editor was proudly recounting the story about an old woman who used an old master's painting to keep her kitchen door open. She sold the painting for almost nothing to the first bidder who understood its real value. He boasted on that occasion that he made an even better deal with a crazy doctor from Czechoslovakia. Yes, I might know something about the Holocaust, but nothing about business in the English press. So he thought. The Daily Herald's circulation increased 40% during the week It carried my 5 articles in March 1961, on the eve of the Eichmann trial. My life and work in London continued in an agreeable way. One of my newly acquired English habits consisted of leaving an empty milk bottle by my front door every morning before I went off to work. I would leave a note in the bottle, listing the amount of eggs, butter, milk, and cream I needed for that particular day. It was all there on my doorstep every evening. On Saturday mornings, when most people were home, the milk deliverer knocked at my door and opened a big book. From this, he read out what I'd consumed during the past week and how much I owed him. I then gave him a check, and he returned to his little 3-wheel delivery van. He was a small man with a strong limp, but he moved fast. He was always polite and brief. During his regular Saturday morning call, shortly after my articles in the Daily Herald were published, he hesitated a few seconds after I gave him my check. He said, almost apologetically, "Excuse me, sir. Do you think you could spare a few minutes? I would like to discuss a private matter with you." "Of course. Please come in," I said. We sat down in my dining room, and he immediately proceeded to tell me his problem. "It is about your articles in this week's Daily Herald," he continued. "I've been a member of our trade union for over 30 years. I have always been a subscriber to the Daily Herald. And I think I have got the right to say that I thoroughly disliked your articles. These articles are meant to create a hatred of Germans among us here in England. To be frank with you, I think you came to this country from Czechoslovakia with the aim of disturbing our good post-war relationship with Germany by spreading incredible lies about the Germans." I was surprised by his straightforward and accusatory approach, but of course, I understood he had little time to spare. The dairy products had to be distributed, and the checks collected. "Why do you think I lied?" I asked. My quiet and matter-of-fact question disarmed him. Almost apologetically, he said, "Please, do not think I am one of those fascists. I am a member of the Labour Party, and I fought against the Germans when it was necessary." He tapped his right leg, the cause of his heavy limp. It was audible that he'd tapped on wood. After a short pause, he added, "I lost my leg as a British soldier during our landing in France in 1944. You could not accuse me being a pro-German. But now, we have peace, and the Germans are our allies. There is no need for anti-German propaganda today. You can believe me that I had no illusions about the Germans in Hitler's time. However, what you are saying now in your articles is just malicious and incredible." "Why do you think it is incredible?" I asked. He paused for a moment. "I shall tell you something about myself," he continued. "I'm a married man. We have 3 children." I listened. He inclined himself toward me and spoke in a lower, confidential tone of voice. "Between us, men, I can tell you that my wife, although a very nice person, is quite a simple woman, indeed, primitive. I dare to say she is rather dumb." He paused again. I wondered what he was trying to tell me. He saw the question mark on my face. Now, he raised his voice and said in an agitated manner, "But try to tell my wife that someone is going to harm our children? She will pick up an axe. She will pick up a kitchen knife. They could harm our children only over her dead body, no matter how dumb she is. And you are trying to tell me that all those clever Jews from all over Europe were taking their children by their hands and delivered them into some sordid gas chambers in Upper Silesia, hundreds of miles away? No. This I cannot believe, he exclaimed. I realized immediately that my articles in the Daily Herald had explained reasonably well what was finally done to the Jews in Auschwitz. However, I had not explained well enough how all this was arranged beforehand by the perfidious German administration of that time. I realized then that I would have to write a book to convey to a thinking person what I had seen at Auschwitz. I would have to describe in detail the intricate German deception that, for lack of better words, some today call the twisted road to Auschwitz. This half sentence does not do justice to the wily, treacherous, and insidious administrative methods used by the Germans to delude the Jews, as well as the whole civilized world. Moreover, the German campaigns against the Jews were intertwined with the use of a fast but uninhibited violence against anyone who did not follow their rules or their order. Furthermore, the German administration always kept at the end of the deportation lines a sufficient number of henchmen to pounce upon selected victims insidiously, but expeditiously, with astonishing cruelty and without any mercy whatsoever. This was an important part of their technique of mass murder. It was obviously far beyond the experience and imagination of my milkman. A year later, I got a letter from Germany, signed by Dr. Dux, the public prosecutor in Frankfurt am Main, asking me to come to Germany to help him prepare the trial against a dozen or so SS officers accused of being the perpetrators of crimes at Auschwitz. Dr. Dux looked for me a long time to ask me to help him in his task, but he had been unable to obtain my address from the Czechoslovak authorities. However, after my articles appeared in the Daily Herald, the German prosecutors had found out I was living in England. They established contact with me. This was the start of a more than 30-year-long cooperation with the German authorities in the prosecution of some of the German criminals who were directly connected with the Holocaust. There are still quite a few around, even while I am writing these lines. During my first post-war visit in Germany in 1962, Dr. Dux showed me a large collection of big black volumes arranged on an enormous bookshelf in his office. I've got here 80 big volumes of written evidence about Auschwitz, and I still do not know everything about Auschwitz, he said. Sometime after my return from my first trip to Germany, Alan Bestic thought that during the upcoming Auschwitz trial, the British public might be interested to read about some of my experiences. After my articles were published by the Daily Herald, I was frequently interviewed on television and radio about problems connected with the prosecution of the SS criminals from Auschwitz. My name became known in London outside my professional circle. Alan soon found a publisher who was prepared to publish a book about my experiences on the condition that the book would be no longer than 200 pages. During my next summer holiday, in August 1963, I had the time to detach myself from work and devote myself to the writing of this book. Alan visited me every day. Each day he took down, in shorthand, one chapter of the book from my dictation, retyped it overnight, and made the editorial and grammatical adjustments to the best of his knowledge and ability. Soon, we felt that 200 pages were too few for all the information we wished to convey. After some negotiation, we obtained the green light to go to a maximum of 300 pages. We finished the work in 18 days, ready for print. Before my 3-week holiday was over, we submitted the manuscript to the printer. The book appeared in the same year, and virtually all major British newspapers reviewed the book positively. It was probably the first book on this subject addressed to the general public rather than to specialists. It was also addressed to my kind milkman. He should know that the leg he lost in the fight against the rule of Nazism was not lost in vain. As we all know, much toil and sweat and tears and blood were lost to defeat the worst enemy of mankind, Nazism. I wrote this book with gratitude to all those who contributed to the defeat of Nazism. I only hope that I, too, have contributed to this end to the best of my knowledge and abilities, and that this book will help to open the eyes of many to prevent the bestial forces which we thought we had broken forever from ever returning. Rudolf Vrba, Vancouver, Canada, May 2002. Chapter 1. A Son Like Me. It was February 1942 in Slovakia, in a small town called Trnava. I sat in the living room, ignoring the Russian grammar that lay open in front of me, for I knew it was no use trying to study anymore. I could hear my mother stomping around in the kitchen next door, banging the saucepans about as if she had a personal grudge against them. And that was a sure sign that there was going to be an argument. There were, I suppose, good grounds for one. An hour earlier, I had told her I was going to England to join the Czechoslovak army in exile, and viewed through my mother's eyes from our little town of Trnava, some 30 miles from Bratislava, England seemed as distant as the unexplored jungles of Peru. Her voice, rancid with sarcasm, rose above the discordant kitchen orchestra and reached me loud and clear through the open door. "Why not slip up to the moon and cut yourself a slice of green cheese, but be back in time for supper?" I said nothing. A delicious smell, a wonderful conglomeration of Wiener Schnitzel, apple strudel, and frying potatoes distracted me momentarily from the debate, which I felt was only beginning anyway. "I don't know where we got you. You're certainly not like any of my side of the family. First this business of learning English, and then, as if that wasn't bad enough, Russian, if you please." A snort. A few more sporadic clanks. Muttering which could have been directed at me or could have been meant for the schnitzel. Then, "Russian? Why can't you settle down like everyone else and learn a decent trade? Where do you get these uppity ideas anyway?" I closed the Russian grammar, went into the kitchen, and said, "Mama, I'm not going to be deported like a calf in a wagon." The saucepans were silent. My mother wiped her hands on her ample, flowing apron, gave me a long, shrewd, penetrating look, sighed, and said, "No, I suppose you're not. I suppose you're right." Then she sprang to the gas stove and hauled a pot off the flame, as if she were saving a child from the Danube. "Now look what you've made me do," she snapped. "You've made me burn the potatoes." In our house, that was a grave crime indeed, for Mama was a proud and excellent cook. Any Jewish mother would have worried about a son like me. For in the independent protectorate of Slovakia, pledged by its president, Father Tiso, to fight side by side with its Nazi benefactors, Jews were not expected to get above their station. Indeed, they were forbidden to do so by law. It was not so much the laws which worried Mama. It was more a matter of conscience, a desire to do the right thing. for her mind had been so molded by the acquiescent elders of her synagogue that she had more or less accepted the status of second-class citizen as something reasonable and proper. When I began learning English, for instance, she clucked about me and worried, as an English parent might worry if the son of the house refused to play cricket and took up baseball. She regarded my studies as an eccentricity. When I added Russian to my curriculum, however, she became so concerned about my mental stability that she took me to the doctor. Luckily, he was a student of Russian himself and was able to assure her that, while my ambitions might be unusual, they were not medically abnormal. Looking back on my own attitude at the time, I am surprised that I too accepted so much so quietly. I can only conclude that it was because the laws curtailing our rights were introduced discreetly, falling almost imperceptibly around us like gentle snow. I became aware of them first at the age of 15, when my name was struck off the roll of the local high school. Private tuition was denied to me too, and I was forbidden to study on my own, a regulation which, of course, was impossible to enforce, and which I ignored. Nevertheless, as I could not go to school, I went to work as a laborer. At work, I found there were two salary scales, a low one for Jews and a higher one for all others. And when I was out of work, I found I had to take second place in the queue at the labor exchange. Jobs went to non-Jews first, and if there were any left over, we were lucky. Next came restrictions on movement. We were allowed to live only in certain towns, and then only in certain areas of those towns, the poorer parts. Travel, too, was curtailed, and we could only move certain distances without permission. And so the ghetto system moved gradually into Slovakia. All this, of course, I resented. Yet I accepted these rulings more or less as some of the unpleasant facts of life. Even when it was decreed that Jews must wear the yellow Star of David on their jackets, I conformed and thought little about it. It was only when the deportation laws were passed by the government that I suddenly rebelled. What precisely triggered rebellion inside me? I do not really know. Perhaps it was because I was 17 by that time, and at last my eyes were open. Perhaps it was because by state decree I became overnight a Jew rather than a Slovak. More probably, it was because I resented being kicked out of my own country. That was the plan. We were told calmly that all Jews were being sent to reservations in Poland, where we could learn to work and build up our own communities. Young, able-bodied men would be the first to go, said the announcement, and this, in the circumstances, seemed reasonable enough. It was only later, of course, that we learned the real motive was to remove the core of potential resistance. I did not know that the reservation was an extermination camp called Auschwitz, a place where I would be expected to die decently and quietly. I simply would not stomach the suggestion that I was no longer a member of the community and that therefore I would have to be cordoned off like a North American Indian. The only difference between us, indeed, was that the Indian was left in his own country. My mother was a strong-minded, self-reliant woman who had built up a small dressmaking business from more or less nothing. She liked to get her own way, but once she gave in, she accepted the new situation wholeheartedly and approached it with unrelenting logic. She slammed a sizzling Wiener Schnitzel down in front of me and said, "How will you get to England? Through Hungary, then to Yugoslavia? If I find I can get no farther, I'll join the Titoists." For a while, she was quiet. I knew she was thinking of the frontiers I would have to cross. of the black-uniformed Slovak Hlinka guards trying hard to ape the SS, of the trigger-happy Hungarian border patrols, of the 1,001 hazards which would face me as I made my way across the tangled boundaries of a Europe at war. Then, having digested these gray thoughts, she said calmly, "You will need clothes, and you will need money." The clothes she managed somehow. Money was more difficult. After a few days, however, she came to me and said, "Here you are, son. It's not much, but it's the best I can do." It was 200 crowns, my fare to England. In the meantime, I had been studying my route. I decided my best plan would be to travel to Sered on the Slovak side of the border and then to make my way across country to Galanta, about 7 or 8 miles away in Hungary. There, a school friend of mine had relatives who he said would help me. The problem was to get from Trnava to Sered, which was miles away, well beyond the limits within which Jews were allowed to travel. Obviously, I could not take a train because there was a constant check on passengers, and I would be arrested before I had gone more than a few miles. And walking would be even more dangerous, for I would be passing through strange country and would be a suspect immediately. It was my mother who thought of the answer, quite casually, for since she had made up her mind about the situation, she had shown little emotion. She said, "You'll have to take a taxi. Your father knows a man who will drive you without asking too many questions." It sounded ridiculous. Who ever heard of anyone taking a taxi ride to freedom? Yet, when I thought of it, I realized my mother was right. It was another week before I was ready to go. The taxi man, a dour, paunchy character with a droopy, tobacco-stained mustache and the doleful face of a bloodhound, was not too happy about the trip, for if he were caught carrying me, he too would be arrested. However, in the name of friendship, he agreed to carry me, and I knew I could trust him implicitly. And so, early in March 1942, I said goodbye to my mother, thanked her for all she had done, and picked up my bag. Her face showed little emotion, and all she said was, "Take care of yourself, and don't forget to change your socks." I did not look back as the taxi drove away, not because I was choked with emotion, but because I was too busy ripping the yellow Star of David from my shoulder. Then, I lay back in the worn leather seats, my stomach twitching with excitement. In my pocket, I had my mother's 200 crowns, a map, and a box of matches. It was not much for the journey I was facing, but I was only a boy of 17 and had yet to learn to calculate risks. Half an hour later, we saw the lights of Sered. And all that time, the driver and I had exchanged only a few words. The tension was mounting in both of us now, and conversation seemed rather out of place. It was only when we stopped in the town, indeed, and I got out to pay him, that we both became a little more voluble. The fare, he told me, was 400 crowns. It was an embarrassing moment for us both. I hauled out my 200 crowns and offered it to him. He gazed at it sadly for a while, scratched his head, tugged at his mustache, and then said with a monumental sigh, "You'd better keep half. You're going to need it. Give me a note to your mother and she can settle up later." He was not a Jew, but he was certainly a friend. I tried to thank him, but he was back in the car and driving off quickly before I could get the proper words out. His mission, and for him it was a dangerous mission, had been completed. I picked up my bags and looked at Sered. Warm lights and laughter beckoned from the cafes. All around me, people scurried home through a whisk of snow. At the far end of the street, I could see a gendarme idling along toward me. So I turned my back on the lights and the laughter and kept on walking until I was out in the country again, away from the warmth that was dangerous. There, I studied my compass by matchlight and headed toward what I hoped was the Hungarian border and Galanta. The snow was falling heavily now, and I was not only cold but suddenly very lonely. The excitement died in the unfriendly darkness, and something very like fear took its place. I marched for hours, pushing my rebellious nerves back into place all the way. And at last, I saw lights ahead of me. It was Galanta. I was in Hungary. My pace quickened, and at 5 o'clock in the morning, I walked into the deserted town, keeping a close watch for patrolling policemen. I found my friend's house with little difficulty, and weak with relief and fatigue, knocked on the impressive door. For a long time, there was silence. I knocked again, more loudly this time, and after what seemed like an hour, I heard distant footsteps. The door opened a few inches, and the frightened face of a maid peered out at me. Then, the door slammed shut. I knocked again and rang the bell, keeping my finger on it and glancing over my shoulder all the time, expecting a policeman to appear at any moment. I heard more footsteps, and then a muttered conversation, so I stopped ringing and the door opened again. A tall, attractive woman in a dressing gown stood looking down at me. I said quickly, "I'm a friend of Stefan's. He said if I called here," she interrupted me. Studying me meticulously, she said very slowly, "You are a friend of Stefan's?" "Yes. We were at high school together." For a long time she stood, staring at me. Then, very reluctantly, she opened the door a little wider and said, "You'd better come in." I was puzzled. Admittedly, it was 5:30 in the morning, but even so, I'd expected a slightly warmer reception from the relatives of my old school friend. And then, as I walked awkwardly into the magnificent hall, I caught a glimpse of myself in a long wall mirror. A dark, sallow-faced youth stared back at me. His hair was tangled and his clothes were covered in mud. His eyes were red-rimmed and slightly wild. He looked like a cross between a bandit and a tramp. Anything less like a student, I could not imagine. I turned to my hostess and said lamely, "I'm sorry. I walked from Sered. I had to go through the fields." Her face stiffened and she almost whispered, "You mean you came here illegally?" I nodded. She raised her handsome eyes to heaven, sighed deeply, shook her head as if she were trying to flick her thoughts into place, and said, "I think you'd better have a bath. We can talk over breakfast." The maid led me to a palatial bathroom, eyeing me all the time as if I had a bomb in my pocket. She turned on the bath and scurried away as fast as her thin legs could carry her. That bath was wonderful, and I wallowed in it for 30 minutes, my tiredness dissolving in the warm, scented water. When I came out, I found that my clothes, which I had left in a dressing room, had been neatly sponged and pressed. I went downstairs, looking and feeling a little more civilized. My hostess and her husband, a burly, elegant man with silver hair, were waiting for me at an amply loaded breakfast table. They made small talk about Stefan while I ate, and only when I had finished did they get down to serious business. It was serious, too. Quietly, my host said, "I suppose you know what conditions are like in Hungary." I drained my third cup of coffee and said cheerfully, "No." I was feeling good now, clean and well-fed. "Well, I think you should know. Here we have martial law, which is bad enough. But in addition, relations between Slovakia and Hungary at the moment could scarcely be worse. The authorities know there is a certain traffic across the border, and anyone who helps a Slovak is jailed immediately for harboring a spy. Splendid breakfast suddenly became a weight on my stomach. I felt dirty again. You mean I'm a danger to you here? He nodded. I rose to go, but he waved me back into my seat immediately. Don't be in such a hurry, he said. This thing will take a bit of organization. If you go out in the street on your own, you'll be picked up in 5 minutes. In fact, I can't understand how you haven't been picked up already. He went to the phone and rang several numbers. Within half an hour, the house seemed full of people. There was a brisk conference at which it was decided that I should leave for Budapest as soon as possible. Again, I stood up. Rather impatiently, my host said, Where are you going? To the station. Great God, boy, he roared. Are you mad? I told you this was going to take organization. It certainly did. One man went with me to the station. Another bought me a ticket, a second-class ticket because people in third-class carriages were liable to talk and ask questions, and those in first-class carriages might report me to the authorities because I had not the cut of a first-class traveler. A third man bought me a copy of the local fascist newspaper to give me an anti-Semitic veneer, and a fourth slipped me about 30 penge. The ticket, the money, and the newspaper were handed to me surreptitiously as the couriers brushed by me with unseeing eyes, and by 9 o'clock, 4 hours after my arrival in Galanta, I was on an express train drawing out of the town. The train whistled through the countryside, and I lay back, pretending to be asleep. The 30 penga and my mother's 100 crowns felt good in my pocket, but in my mind, I had an even more valuable asset than money. It was the address of a socialist underground worker in Budapest, given to me by my friends in Trnava. Pista, they said, would help me on my way. I called on his home immediately, a dingy little flat in a working-class area. A woman in black eyed me nervously and said, He's away. Call on his brother and he may be able to contact him for you. She scribbled down the address, which I noticed was in a more fashionable district, and off I went, feeling that at last I was getting control of the situation. At the house, I was ushered in immediately, as if I were an old friend, and coffee and cakes were produced. As I ate, I told them my story. The brother of the underground worker listened without comment, and then gave a wry smile. This is a bit embarrassing, he said. You see, I'm a member of the local fascist organization. I stiffened and began to feel sick. I was caught, and not only that, but I had confessed everything into the bargain, even to the extent of involving my friends in Galanta. I glanced quickly at the door and the window, then, to my amazement, my fascist host began to roar with laughter. Relax, he said. Lots of us are in the organization now. It's good for business and health. You stay here for a while until we see what's the best thing to do with you. In fact, I stayed with him for 10 days, by which time I felt I was abusing his hospitality. So I went to him and said, I must get a job. I think I'll go along to the Zionists and see if they can help me get documents and then some work. To me, it sounded a sensible idea, but my host was far from enthusiastic. My friend, he said, I don't think you'll get a very warm welcome. Why not? They'll have to help me. He shrugged and went back to his party files, which were spread all over the table. That afternoon, I went to Omja House, headquarters of the Zionist organization in Budapest. There, I told my story in detail to a stern-faced man in his middle 30s. He pondered a while before he said, "You are in Budapest illegally. Is that what you're trying to say?"
"Yes."
"Don't you know you're breaking the law?" I nodded, wondering how a man with such a thick skull could hold down what seemed like a responsible position. "And you expect to get work here? Without documents?"
"With false documents."
Had I torn up the Talmud and jumped on it, I do not think I could have shocked him more. His mouth opened once or twice, and then he roared, "Don't you realize it's my duty to hand you over to the police?" Now, it was my turn to gape, a Zionist handing a Jew over to fascist police. I thought I must be going mad. "Get out of here! Get out as fast as a bad wind!" I left, utterly bewildered. It was nearly 3 years before I realized what Omja House and the men inside it represented. My fascist friend was not surprised when I told him what had happened. He agreed, however, that it would be better if I left Budapest in case the Zionist official did report me to the police. So once again, I became the center of a family conference. Ultimately, it was decided that I should return to Slovakia, and that there, in my hometown of Trnava, friends would wait for me with false documents, which would show that I was a nice, clean Aryan. I could see only one flaw in an otherwise excellent plan. "The journey from Galanta to Sered can be tricky," I said. "What if I'm delayed?" "Don't worry. They understand the difficulties. They'll wait for 6 days." I realized then that I was dealing with men who were not only patient but courageous, too. To hang around border towns for a week was to beg for a rest. The machinery I had known in Galanta went into reverse. At Budapest station, I was handed my ticket, some money, and a fascist newspaper, each by a different agent. I boarded the express, and 3 hours later, I was in the outskirts of Galanta, making for the fields and the frontier. I was feeling quite a veteran by that time. After all, I was in familiar country, and I had learned a good deal since I had said goodbye to my mother a fortnight or so earlier. In fact, I was feeling reasonably happy as I plodded on through the mud. Then, it happened. From the darkness, a voice rasped, "Halt!" I stopped and turned slowly. Dimly, I could see the outline of two Hungarian frontier guards. A wan moon glinted on the barrels of their rifles. I whirled and began to run, plunging frantically through the heavy soil. I heard more shouts and then the shots. I stopped, panting, frightened. Had I been a little more experienced, of course, I would have kept going, for their chances of hitting me in the dark and on the move were slight. But this piece of elementary military strategy, I was to learn only later, much later. I turned again to face them. They were plodding cautiously toward me, rifles at the ready. Then, one stood back to cover me while the other came close. He reversed his rifle and clouted me quickly on the side of the head, spinning me into the soft, cloying earth. A boot bit into my groin. I writhed as pain washed over numbness, and the sky wheeled above my head. From far away, a voice rapped, "Where are you going?" I managed to gasp, "To Budapest." "Get up!" I tried, but failed. They dragged me to my feet and half-marched, half-bludgeoned me to the frontier post. There were about 10 other guards there. They looked at me with no more than idle curiosity, for this, to them, was a nightly routine. Then they began to question me in a rather bored fashion. Again, I was asked, "Where are you going?" "To Budapest." A fist crunched into my mouth, flinging me against the wall. "Who do you know in Budapest?"
"Nobody."
A corporal with a pockmarked face slowly drew his revolver,
tossed it in the air, and caught it by the barrel. He hit me full in the face with the butt, and as I fell, the room filled with fireworks. Slowly I opened my eyes. I could see a shiny boot inches from my face. Again, the voices were far away, and hands were hauling me erect. "You're a spy. Admit it." I blinked at him stupidly, then shook my head. The taste of blood was in my mouth, and my lips were so swollen I could barely speak, but I managed to mutter, "Going to Budapest." They were my last words for half an hour. For now, the pattern had been established, a question, a blow, a question, a blow. Even had I been willing to speak, I could not have done so because my mind was so scrambled. I was becoming almost numb to the blows, in fact, perhaps because I was semi-conscious, when suddenly they stopped. Through a haze, I noticed everyone in the room standing stiffly to attention. With an effort, I turned my head and saw a smartly dressed officer standing in the door. Now, at least, I thought, there will be no more beating, no more savagery. Officers behave like gentlemen. He was a heavy, smooth-faced man in his early 30s, and he sat down behind his table with a sad, almost self-pitying sigh. For a few minutes, he sifted through the bits and pieces the rough soldiers had taken from my pockets. A rather grubby handkerchief, some coins, a few inconsequential scraps of paper. Another deep sigh, which seemed to ask the good Lord to look down kindly on all duty officers. He looked up and gazed at me for a while. It was not an unsympathetic gaze. It indicated, rather, that we both were victims of circumstances which we found equally distasteful, and that it would have been much easier for all concerned if I had not been arrested at all. In fact, I began to relax a little. The soldiers had not found my most important possession, my money, which I had sewn into the fly of my trousers. I knew, too, that I carried no written evidence, no addresses, nothing which might betray my friends in Budapest. His face and his voice were mild as he asked the dog-eared old question, "Where were you going?" "To Budapest. I'm a Slovak Jew. I didn't want to be deported. I've just crossed the border." His forehead puckered with creases, and he began to toy with one of the scraps of paper. He smoothed it out in front of him and glanced at me, almost reproachfully. Something in his manner made me stare at that piece of paper too, and my stomach twisted as I recognized it. It was a Budapest tram ticket. Ponderously, he came from behind the table, and skillfully he hit me twice. Two soldiers stood respectfully behind me to prop me up for the next assault. The next question: "Where did you live in Budapest?" "I lived rough, in parks, places like that." Another blow that seemed to move slowly but rocketed me back into the arms of the soldiers. "You're a spy. Who were your accomplices?" "I'm not a spy. I'm a refugee. I have no accomplices." Now, I was frightened. Not for myself, but for all those who had helped me, my fascist friend and the men who had smuggled me out of the capital. I was afraid this smooth-faced man would make me talk, for obviously he was an expert at the job. Wearily, he held out his hand. Immediately, a soldier handed him a short truncheon. The two soldiers who had been standing behind me forced me back onto a table, and then he went to work on my face with an efficiency that made the earlier efforts of his subordinates seem amateurish, wasteful. The blows sliced into my face, short, savage blows that fell with the monotonous regularity of the questions. Names and addresses trickled to the tip of my tongue. only to be sent scurrying back again by some force in my mind that I did not know existed.
You're a spy. Who are your friends? Where do they live?
My eyes disappeared beneath puffs of flesh, and the blood on my face began to cake. My world was encompassed by that truncheon, and though I could see no longer, I never lost consciousness. The truncheon invaded my brain, but it never managed to take over completely. Despite the fact that the efficient officer worked on me for 3 hours. After that, he stopped, not because he had grown weary, but because he had become convinced that I must be telling the truth. Now his only problem was to dispose of me quickly and neatly, for there was no place in his life or his barracks for minnows like me. Dimly, I heard him say to a couple of soldiers, "Take him back to the border." The usual treatment. The usual treatment. Battered though I was, I realized I was going to be killed and dumped in the no man's land of the frontier. And somehow, the thought was not terribly frightening. Any emotions I had, indeed, were a blending of pride that I had not been broken and relief that my friends were safe. They dragged me back through the fields, and the fresh air revived me a little. After a while, when I knew we must be near the frontier, we stopped, and one of the soldiers said, "Give me your money." For a moment, a foolish moment, I thought I might be able to buy my life. I ripped the money from my trousers and held it out.
"Throw it on the ground, you Slovak bastard."
I flung it on the ground. Never taking his eyes off me, he picked it up, thrust it into his pocket, and said, "Keep marching." I kept marching, sick at my own stupidity. Soon, however, our pace slackened again and we made another stop. I heard one soldier mutter, "We've balled this up. I think we're in Slovakia." The other swore quietly but viciously and grunted, "That means we can't shoot him. One shot, and they'll have the dogs and machine guns on us.
We'd better bayonet him."
I twisted fast and saw one of them coming at me with a naked bayonet. I screamed. He punched me to the ground, flung himself on top of me, and pressed his hand over my mouth. His colleague stood like a frightened cat, gazing into the darkness. The bayonet was at my throat. I could feel it pricking my skin. Then the pricking stopped, and the soldier who had been sitting on me rose slowly. The pair of them stood rigid, silent, and suddenly I realized that they were much more frightened than I was. Minutes passed. One of them whispered,
"Get up. Get out of here."
I got up and began walking away from them. I walked 15 yards, and then I ran, zigzagging, ducking, weaving, waiting for a bullet which never came. I ran wildly for 100 yards before I tripped and fell. It seemed like the end of the line, the end of resistance, the end of everything. I lay, my face buried in the earth, grunting with exhaustion, beaten, semi-conscious. How long I lay there, I do not know. It may have been minutes. It may have been hours. I may have slept or I may have lost consciousness, but when at last my eyes creaked open, a dog was panting in my face. All I could see was the piercing beam of a flashlight which cut into me like a knife. I heard a voice say in Slovak, "Jesus, he's still alive." Someone lifted me to my feet. It was a Slovak frontier guard, and he gazed at me in something like awe. He said, "You should be dead. We always find them dead." He shouted for another guard. Between them, they half carried me through the fields until we came to a village. There, they kicked at the door of an inn until the owner came grumbling down to open it. The sight of me, however, my face decorated by the Hungarians, my clothes torn and stained with mud and blood, changed his humor at once. He ushered us in, and within minutes I was lying in a huge armchair, sipping brandy. A woman appeared with a basin of warm water and gently began to bathe my face. The mists disappeared with the blood, and I realized I was back among human beings. Still, those frontier guards had to do their job. They took me to the police station and began questioning me. I told them the truth. The guard who had picked me out of the mud frowned and said, "So, you don't want to go to a resettlement area? You don't want to work, you dirty, bloody yid. I should beat you so your mother wouldn't recognize you. But that's been done already." He pushed me into a cell, locked it, and went about his business. I lay on the plank bed, aching, stiff, and began to doze. A voice woke me, the voice of an old woman. It said, "Mr. Jew, are you asleep?" I traced it to the bars of my cell window. Heaving myself up with an effort that hurt, I said, "No." Through the bars fell some cigarettes and some food. News that a Jew had been picked up somewhere along the frontier, it seemed, had traveled fast through that Slovak village, and somewhere a Christian woman had thought of him lying alone and maybe hungry. That this was arranged by the local Jews for money, I learned only later. Much later. Chapter 2. I became a wanted man. June is a beautiful month in Slovakia, and in 1942 it excelled itself. The sun was warm and benign, constant. The fields were heavy with lush amber wheat, waving lazily in gentle breezes, and the birds sang as if they were cheering their heads off at the success of the whole show. Even from behind the barbed wire of Novaki Camp, the world looked lovely. Indeed, probably the only person there who did not take time off from his worries occasionally to gaze at the scenery was Mr. Jew. They had taken me there the morning after my arrest, and now I sat on the edge of my bunk, brooding over the irony of my position and cursing quietly to myself. For weeks, I'd been scampering to and fro, ducking to avoid bullets, absorbing punishment, risking my neck and the necks of others, all in a grim effort to evade being sent to a resettlement area, and all I had managed to do was land myself on the launching ramp itself. On my arrival, they bundled me into a huge barracks that held several hundred men, most of them a good deal older than I was. I still was not quite sure why I was there or what was going to happen, but listening to the conversation all around me, I soon found out. It was tedious, doleful, and boring, revolving endlessly around bribes that had been wasted, about promises that had been broken, about corruption and deceit and injustice, and most of all, about transports. When would the next train come? Would there be a next train? Had the whole transportation business been called off? For hours, they kicked the dreary subject round that big wooden barracks like kids on a rubbish dump, kicking a football made of rags. I realized then that I was in a transit camp, that the next stop was somewhere in Poland, where I would be taught to work like a civilized human being, where my Jewish vices would be purged, where I would help build a new, decent community. For a while, I cursed a little less quietly, and when I had worked the bile out of my system, I began looking around me to see what could be done about the situation. A tall, slightly balding man on the bunk beside me was saying, "I gave him 500 crowns, and he said I had nothing to worry about. And now?" I interrupted him. "Tell me," I said, "what are the chances of getting out of here? The monologue died. I felt a dozen pairs of eyes on me. Someone laughed and said, "Listen to him. Here as long as a wet day, and now he wants to go home." A paunchy merchant glared at me and rapped, "Jesus, that's all we need, a bloody troublemaker." And the man who had lost his 500 crowns nodded towards the door and said, "Out there are two Hlinka guards. Try to get past them and they'll shoot you for a rat. The only time you leave this barracks is when you want to go to the shithouse, and even then, you've a rifle at your navel." It did not sound very encouraging, but when I investigated further, I found that the situation was not without promise. I learned that Novaki was divided into two camps, one, the transit section, which held those awaiting transport to Poland, and the other, a labor camp, where the more favored Jews were supposed to work for the good of the Slovak government. Everyone looked with longing towards the labor camp. Everyone was trying to get into it, for at least it meant a reprieve from the unknown. But not everyone had the necessary qualifications, which were money, influence within the Zionist movement, or some specialist knowledge. Doctors, carpenters, and blacksmiths, for instance, had a good chance of passing that vital frontier. That ruled me out. I had no influence, no trade, no money. Nevertheless, I had been on the road long enough by this time to realize there was always a back door, and it was not long before I found one. The Hlinka guards wanted someone to fetch food for the transit camp from the labor camp. I volunteered immediately, and the others let me have the job because they knew I had no food and they were still receiving parcels from home. This meant at least I could get out of the barracks without going to the lavatory. On my very first trip, I realized here was the back door, not only to the open air and the sunshine, but to freedom. Because everyone wanted to get into the labor camp and nobody thought of getting out, it was surrounded by a pathetically inadequate barbed wire fence, and only one Hlinka guard patrolled this perimeter, which was about 1,000 yards long. I noticed, too, that the Hlinka guard who escorted me was much more interested in feeding his face and drinking slivovitz in the kitchen than he was in me. Had I wished, I could have slipped away that very day and gone through the wire, and nobody would have missed me for at least an hour. Experience, however, had taught me caution. I knew by now that a man on the run needs clothes. Before I went, I would have to transfer some gear to the labor camp and find someone I could trust to hide it for me. So, for the next few days, I studied the faces around me every time I went to the labor camp. Most of them were discouraging, the smug, flaccid faces of the rich and the wealthy. In fact, it was a week before I singled out a man I thought would be ready to help someone other than himself. He was a stout little plumber who always seemed to be working on the taps in the kitchen. He smiled a lot and sang at his work, an optimist among a brooding bunch of pessimists. Still, I had to be sure. One day I took off my jacket and said to him, "Would you look after this for me until tomorrow? It's too hot to wear it today." He lowered his spanner and gave me a long, shrewd look. Then he grinned and said, "Sure, I'll put it in my locker in the barracks." Next day, I took a pair of socks, and this was the crucial test. This time he would know perfectly well that I was not worrying about the weather. He would know my mind was on the barbed wire. Casually, I said, "Could you stow these away for me somewhere?" Without a word, he took them and shoved them quickly into his pocket. I had found my man. After that, I transported my not very extensive wardrobe up to the labor camp, more or less, sock by sock.
I even managed to take my briefcase along one day, making some fatuous excuse to my rather stupid escort. All this took time, of course, but by the end of 6 weeks, I was ready to go. Luck, indeed, was not just running my way. It was galloping. Before I went, I had to face up to one last problem, the old-fashioned problem of money. For my last pennies had long since disappeared down the throats of the Hungarian frontier guards, and even that was solved almost miraculously. I had become friendly in the transit barracks with a tall, handsome lad called Josef Knapp, who came from Topolčany, the town where I was born, and who, like me, had tried unsuccessfully to escape to Britain through Hungary. "I must be the unluckiest bastard in the world," he said to me one day. "Over in Topolčany, just a few miles away, I've got one of the loveliest girls you ever saw in your life. We were going to get married in the autumn. We've got a father with so much money that he can't count the stuff, and here I am, in bloody Novaki, waiting to be sent to God knows where in a filthy cattle truck." "Quickly, perhaps too quickly," I said. "You've got money?" He nodded glumly and said, "What I wouldn't give to see her for just 5 minutes." "You've got money here in the camp?" "Sure. As much as I want outside." "Listen, Josef," I said, "I'm leaving here, going under the wire in a few days. How about you coming along?" After that, it was ridiculously simple. I persuaded the Hlinka guards that I needed an assistant on the food run because the camp was filling up. He agreed without giving the matter too much thought. And 3 days later, I was in the labor camp kitchen again, this time with my banker by my side. Quietly, I said to my friend the plumber, "May I have my gear?" He nodded and walked casually out of the kitchen. I glanced at my escort, saw he was stuck deep into a hunk of meat, and walked after the plumber, Knapp, by my side. At his barracks, my temporary valet handed me my briefcase, already packed. Then he slipped 500 crowns into my hand and said, "Good luck. God bless you." He disappeared before I could even start thanking him. There was no sign of the patrolling guard. Knapp and I went under the wire, and 3 minutes later were sliding down the high banks of a stream that trickled down from the nearby forests. Another 10 minutes, and we were deep inside that forest, laughing our heads off. It was the laughter of pure exhilaration. Novaki was behind us. Novaki with its long faces, its dreary, defeatist talk, its moans and its whines. The sun flickered through the trees as we marched, and to me, the Slovak scene had never looked lovelier. We had been walking for about 2 hours when we heard a strange sound. Right in the heart of the forest, we heard the cheers of a crowd rising and falling, lilting like music neither of us had heard for a long time. Josef frowned for a moment and said, "I know this place. Believe it or not, there's a football stadium in this forest. I used to go there every Sunday." Then he turned to me with a grin and said, "This is Sunday. There's a match on. What are we waiting for?" We did not wait. We almost ran to that stadium, and soon the pair of us, two fugitives from a resettlement camp, were cheering ourselves hoarse, abusing the referee, the players, the linesmen, losing ourselves utterly in an hour that seemed to have been snatched straight from the past. At halftime, we drank beer, ate sausages, and winked at the girls. Then we plunged back into the crowd, and the cheering swept over us, washing away the memory of Novaki and all thought of the future. It was quite a few hours before we remembered just who we were and where we were. To be precise, it was midnight.
After the match, we wandered on through the forest, still chewing sausages like a couple of trippers. When it grew dark, we lay down in a cornfield and slept immediately, still drunk on the air of freedom. At midnight, however, we both woke up. In the distance, we could hear the low rumble of a distant train and the long, lonely sound of its whistle. We sat silently and watched until we could see its headlights splitting the darkness and the orange glow of the fire in the cabin. Another few minutes, and it was passing us, a goods train, with its wagons clanking and jostling each other. And still we sat, watching, silent, until the red light of the guard's van disappeared in the distance. "Wonder what it's carrying," said Yosef. "Cattle? Coal?" I looked at the train that had come from God knows where and was going God knows where and said, "Or Jews." We scrambled to our feet and began walking. A distant whistle shattered the last of our football match illusions. We were heading, in fact, for the village of Velike Uherce, where Yosef had friends. He could not go into Topolchini because he was too well known there, and so I, who had not been there since I was 3 years old, was going to contact his girlfriend for him. "Just tell her the name of the village," said Yosef. "She'll know which house. She'll look after you, and once I've seen her, I'll see you're fixed up with anything you need." It sounded fine. Now I had a rich backer. We parted a couple of miles from Velike Uherce, and I set off for Batevoce, where I knew I could get a train for Topolchini. It was still only 5 o'clock when I reached the outskirts of the town, a dangerous hour. If I walked into Batevoce at that hour, I was courting arrest because nobody but the police would be around, so to kill time, I wandered into a country graveyard, sat on a tombstone, and waited. There, I felt sure I would be safe, for who would go visiting graves at 5 o'clock in the morning? My theory was reasonable. In practice, it did not work out. At 5:30, an old peasant woman wandered in and laid a bunch of flowers on a grave. She glanced at me and then toddled away, thinking perhaps how sad it was to see one so young filled with sorrow. By 8 o'clock, I was in Batevoce station. An hour later, I was in Topolchini, sitting in the parlor of a neat little suburban house, telling my story to Zuzka, Yosef's girlfriend. She listened without a word, hardly able to believe me, for she thought he was in Hungary. Then she said, "I must go to him at once. Mama will look after you until I get back. I won't be long." With that, she was gone, having babbled out a garbled version of my story to her parents, who seemed to have mixed feelings about me. "Any friend of Yosef's is a friend of ours, of course," said Papa with a rather shaky smile. "But it's a little difficult just now. You see, they're rounding up the Jews in Topolchini. It makes it rather embarrassing." Suddenly, I realized this was not a Jewish household. If they were caught harboring me, it would be more than a little difficult. It would be downright dangerous. No wonder the poor old folk were scared out of their wits of me. "Would you mind very much," said Papa, his face wrinkled like a worried prune, "if we put you in the shed?" I told them their shed would be a palace compared with Novaki, and out I went to it, followed by Mama and a huge meal. As I ate it among the spades and the forks and the rakes, I thought, soon Zuzka will be back with some money. Then, off to Trnava to collect the false documents that my Hungarian friends organized for me. A few hours later, Mama came in with another meal. I asked whether Zuzka had returned, but she shook her head. And as meal followed meal,
and began to feel worried. Velge u Herce, after all, was only half an hour away, and they both knew I was waiting. That night, I slept in the shed. The following morning, Mama brought me my breakfast. Zuska? There was still no sign of her, and by that time I was not really worried anymore. I was furious. I had been left in the lurch by the man I had carried out of jail. He had got what he wanted, his girlfriend, and that made me redundant. Still, I decided to give him another day. After all, I felt they had not seen each other for a long time. The trouble was that Papa was not quite so patient. That afternoon, he came to me, his face twitching with embarrassment, making me feel almost sorry for him. "It's all very difficult," he said, "but she hasn't come back." I said nothing. "It's so dangerous these days. What with the police and all these raids and—" I stood up, emptied my bag, stuffed what I could into my pockets, and put on a second pair of socks, for that was the easiest way to carry them. Then, leaving my bag in the shed, people with bulging bags are always suspect, I thanked him for his hospitality and went out into Topolchini, town of my birth. I walked with mixed feelings. I felt pleasantly nostalgic as blurred memories cleared, and I recognized a building here and there. I saw middle-aged people and wondered if they remembered my father. Somehow, I felt at home in Topolchini. On the other hand, it was an uncomfortable journey. The shoes which had carried me to and fro across the Hungarian border and in and out of jail hardly had any soles left. I was sloping along, like a tramp. And though I still had the 500 crowns my friend the plumber had given me, I knew I could not fritter it away on luxuries. The answer to this problem came to me as I passed what I knew was a Jewish house. It had no Star of David hanging on the front door, but the signs were unmistakably there, the signs of the times. In the front garden, there was furniture. Here were people about to be deported, and as soon as they were gone, the authorities would auction the furniture for peppercorn prices and buy another quisling by handing over the house to him. I walked up the path beside the neat little garden and knocked. A tall, angular man who looked like an ex-school teacher opened the door, and I told him my story, the whole story. He listened without interrupting, and when I had finished, he said, "I knew your father. But I'm sorry. I can't help you." He gestured vaguely in the direction of the furniture and went on, "You see the way it is. We haven't much money, and we'll need every penny of what we have for the journey." I told him quickly that I did not want money and added tentatively, "But if you had an old pair of shoes?" He disappeared without a word and returned with an almost new pair of brown shoes in his hand.
"Here," he said, "take these. They belong to my son, but he won't be needing them anymore. He went 2 months ago."
Those shoes, owned perhaps by someone I had known in Novaki, fitted me perfectly and boosted my morale to the treetops. I went waltzing down the street now, saw a milk bar and decided to celebrate my luck. And freedom is such a heady affair that the pint I drank had the light-hearted taste of champagne. Even the sight of a gendarme striding into the milk bar did not depress me. He was a tall, middle-aged man with a monumental mustache, saber clanking by his side, carbine over his shoulder, revolver in its holster on his shiny belt. He greeted everybody cheerfully, smiled at me, and I smiled back quite happily. At that moment, even gendarmes, most active of all branches of the police force, could not cast a shadow over my optimism. I finished my milk and wandered out into the sunshine.
It was too early to go to the station to catch the train for Trnava, so on the spur of the moment I decided to make a short sentimental journey, to wander by the house in which I was born. The street was photographed on my mind. Every gate had some fragment of a memory. My mind, in fact, was miles away when I heard the squeal of bicycle brakes behind me. It was the gendarme. He towered over me on a bike as big as a horse and said with great formality, "Good afternoon. May I see your documents, please?" I stared at him, unable to speak. To me at that moment, he was not just a gendarme in a country town. He was the Hungarian frontier guards with their rifle butts. He was Novaki in all its dismal squalor. He was a train that had come from God knows where and was going to God knows where. I screamed and ran blindly, wildly, with the creak of his bicycle lancing my nerves. I could hear the clank of his saber and thought of his carbine, which I knew he would use as a last resort. Weaving, ducking, I reached the kiosk at the end of the street and rounded it. He lurched after me. 4 times we tore around that kiosk. And then I doubled back up the street again, sick with panic. The bicycle strained after me, still creaking. I knew I had to stay in this one stretch, up and down the houses I knew so well. For once I left it, once I went into the wider roads beyond it, he could pick me off with his carbine. He was abreast of me now. I stopped, turned back, and headed for the kiosk again. Over my shoulder, I could see him dismounting, lifting his bicycle around to save time, vaulting into the saddle like a cavalryman. Up and down we went, panting, braking, turning. How he managed to keep the saber out of the spokes, I shall never know, but manage he did. And he knew I would tire before he did. People stopped to stare at this crazy, comical, terrible hare and hound chase. Crowds gathered. They cheered the pair of us. And for me, that was bad, for now he had to catch me as a matter of honor, or never raise his head into Polchny again. Desperately, I searched for a foxhole. Then fear twitched my memory into action, and I thought of a laneway that led into the freedom of the fields. I found it, ducked down it, and ran into a block of fine new buildings. The fields of my childhood had been urbanized. I stopped, panting, sweating. I heard the bicycle clatter to the ground behind me and turned to see the gendarme standing over me, saber held high. He roared, "Halt or I strike!" We were both exhausted, but I was beaten. More quietly, he said, "Are you a Jew or a thief?" "A Jew." Slowly he lowered the saber. Still gasping, he said, "You are lucky. If you'd been a thief, I'd have let you have it. I'll have you know I hurt my knee turning that bike after you." We studied each other in silence for a few moments while we recovered. And when he had stopped blowing at last, he told me, "I don't blame you running." I did the same when the Cossacks came at me with sabers on the Russian front. I realized then that I'd been caught by a man of character. A man who had fought for the Habsburgs, for little money. A man who had learned understanding the hard way. Still, he had his duty to do. And he did it. He had to display me to the town to show them all that the fugitive had not escaped the net of justice, which he represented, to demonstrate that right, as usual, had triumphed. So, saber rampant, he marched me ostentatiously through the streets and the crowds, who, a few minutes earlier had cheered me, now gazed at me fearfully, wondering whom I had murdered. He did not speak to me again until we were near the police station. Then he said, Do you know why I asked for your documents? I shook my head. Because when I was in the milk bar, I saw you were wearing 2 pairs of socks. 2 pairs of socks in this weather. Those 2 pairs of socks helped me on my way to Auschwitz. In the police station, the atmosphere was informal. They said, "Give us 1,000 crowns and you can go." To me, that seemed a reasonable offer, apart from the fact that I didn't have 1,000 crowns. I gave them every penny I had, every penny that was left from the 500 I had been given just before I ducked under the barbed wire at Novaki. It came to about 400 crowns. I watched them divide it carefully and fairly between them, and when they had pocketed their dividends, one of them turned to me with a smile and said, "Sorry, it's not enough. We'll have to send you back to Novaki." This raised a big laugh, and as I glanced at the sergeant's desk, I realized why. There was a warrant for my arrest, and a full description of me, which had been circulated to all police stations in Slovakia. If I'd had 3,000 crowns, it would have made no difference. There was nothing else they could do except send me back. To pass the time, they questioned me, casually. One of them said, "You've an aunt still living in town. Why not ask her for some money? We'll send around a message if you like." I told them not to bother. I had learned my lesson, so they shrugged and began to debate what they would do with me that night, for normally the station was locked up, and they all went home to bed. At last, after a lengthy conference, the sergeant came to me and, speaking more or less man to man, said, "Look, we're going to lock you in the cells and leave you on your own until the morning. Don't be too downhearted about the situation, because it could be worse." He tugged at his mustaches and shot me a glance from under his shaggy eyebrows. He seemed to be searching for a phrase, trying to find a nice way to say something unpleasant, for after all, I was from Topolchany and deserved some consideration. At last he muttered, "Don't do anything silly. I mean, if we find you dead here in the morning, we'll only have to bury you, and that wouldn't be nice for you, a Topolchany boy, now would it?" I told him it would be far from nice, and told him I had no intention of killing myself. He smiled, gave me some cigarettes, locked me in my cell, and left me on my own to think about the future. Next morning, they took me to the railway station. Again, there were crowds to watch me go. And just as we were about to enter the station, a little blonde-haired girl darted forward and thrust a parcel into my hands, tears streaming down her face. It was my little cousin, Lisi, then only about 13. Years later, I learned that someone had told her that her cousin was being taken away by the police. She had dashed into a shop with her few pennies and bought me all that she could afford. Cherries. Linka guards took charge of me at the station. We did not talk much on the journey back to Novaki, but they did not mind eating my cherries. At the camp, I was not received with brass bands or garlands of flowers, for the men who should have been guarding me had gotten into trouble over my escape. The sergeant in charge of the guard room beamed at me as I was let in and said, "Good morning, sir. We've been expecting you. This is indeed a pleasure." He gave a short little military bow and smashed his fist into my face. I flew back against a table and sent it crashing into a group of Hlinka guards who were drinking coffee. The coffee went all over their uniforms, and that did not help much either. Slowly, they encircled me. Methodically, they beat me with their fists, their boots, and their rifles, passing me from hand to hand so everyone would get his fair share. Then, as suddenly as it had all started, it stopped. I saw them all, staring sheepishly at the door, and my eyes followed theirs. An SS officer was standing there, surveying them superciliously. "See that this man doesn't go back to the camp," he snapped. "He's a troublemaker. Keep him in the guard room, and make sure he is sent away on the next transport." He saved me from further beating, but not because he had any sympathy for me. I think he probably felt the Hlinka men might kill me. If that happened, the news might filter through to the other deportees and upset them. The SS did not want their charges upset. They wanted them to go nicely and cheerfully to the gas chambers, without causing any hitch. The Hlinka men, anyway, seemed to be impressed. They looked at me with a new interest, realizing I was more than a football to be kicked around the floor. I was important, and accordingly I was led away to a special cell. They pushed me in and locked the door. A huge man in the uniform of a Slovak soldier looked up. I saw it bore insignia to show that he was a Jew. I also saw that his face, like mine, was black and blue, though, unlike mine, it was creased with a wide smile of welcome. "Good evening," he said. "Who are you?" I introduced myself. "From Topolchini." "I was born in Topolchini." He stood up and roared with laughter. I didn't see anything funny in either my name or the fact that I was born in Topolchini until he said, "Your father did business with my father. He owed us a lot of money when he died. But don't worry. You need not pay me back just now. Have some salami. Have a drink of water." He told me his name was Ferro Langer, and that he was the son of a wealthy businessman in Telgert. He had been conscripted into the Jewish forced labor detachments of the Slovak army, and had used his uniform to bluff his way into Novaki to help a relative who was being transported. "Trouble was," he said with his huge grin, "they posted me as a deserter. Have that salami, and then we'll have a game of Skittles." About a yard of salami hung on the door. I bit off a chunk of it, looked at him hard, and said, "Skittles?" "Yes, like this." He took a loaf of bread and broke it in half. One half he stood at the end of the room. The other he rolled into hard little pellets. He rolled one at the half loaf of bread, missed by a mile, and said very seriously, "Your turn. We'll play for salami." For 4 days, we played Skittles for that hunk of salami on the door. Even then, there was still plenty of it left. For though we had plenty of practice, we found that breadcrumb Skittles is a tricky game. At the end of those 4 days, Ferry lost his partner. The Hlinka guards opened the door of the cell and took me out. My transport, they said, awaited me. I was sad to leave that cell. But just before.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.